well. I'm back. Back in the saddle, as it were. And today, I have the fabulous Ross Cockle with me. Now, and the reason Ross is here is, Ross, you were the engineer on the first Little River Band album. We've just been admiring this front cover. It's wonderful, isn't it? Hey, we're not sure, actually.
Oh, no, I'm positive.
It's You're not, positive. You actually
very good.
You laughed when you first saw it.
I was shocked when it came out, but that's okay. It became the product, and was good. The word was out.
The faces were out, yeah.
I just didn't understand it at all, but that's okay.
I don't think anyone did, but we just kind of ran with it, I think.
But that's when the first logo happened.
Yes, exactly. So, look, this is going to take some time because we're going all the way back to 1975, and I'm going to attempt to play the original long version of It's a Long Way There. This is the song that really started it all for the band. It wasn't a massive hit as such, but it's become a classic.
It seemed to be perfect for FM radio that was coming out in America. And
Oh, absolutely, in Jacksonville, yeah.
I forgot that it was over eight minutes long.
It is.
It didn't seem like that at the time we were recording it.
No,
but
no.
Because, you know,
because it's so damn interesting and so good.
It is interesting, and the fact that you played it pretty much live in the studio was one of the great things for me, which has stuck with me all this way. And I try to get bands to do that. From then on, some weren't as prepared as you guys were, but you were.
Well, you're right. We were a well-oiled machine. God, there's so. I don't want to go into an hour rave about the beginnings of the band.
No.
Man, it was 75. I was 21. I don't know how old you were at the time.
75?
Yeah.
20.
Okay, so you're actually a year younger than me.
Mm.
I mean, do you realise how young we were and the history that we were actually making? I mean, and the other thing I realised is that the three significant albums that I've recorded back in the 70s, all of which have gone gold and platinum, you were the engineer. So it's a pretty amazing history. I mean, you have... let's talk about you for a minute, Ross. I mean, Your contribution to Australian rock and roll and the amount of incredible albums and singles that you have recorded and produced is quite, I saw a list the other day. I was flabbergasted.
Did I send it to you? No, probably not.
I was something on a Facebook. It was it was little thumbnails of all the albums that you played on.
That might have been on. I've gone back and picked up, good or bad, every cover.
Oh, I know.
Did, and some I've forgotten, and I'll put them up there. And you just, it's just this plethora of images. And
well,
things.
It is, but it's pretty amazing. I mean, it's your moment in the sun. I mean, are some of the other significant records that you have engineered or produced?
Well, I wanted to say that this was probably the third album of music that I did.
Yeah,
the first
okay.
one was a beautiful music album with a guy called Brian Rangott, who was the MD at Channel 9 at the time. And that was, I don't know why, what happened back then is if one engineer didn't want to do a job, the next tier
of engineers... you were a house engineer at AAB.
So without, but why I'm mentioning that is because that was an orchestral album with a very well-known MD, but he was a TV guy, so as long as he could hear something... And I hadn't done, I've done string sections and different forms of classical music or orchestral music. But that was an album, and I still got, it was nice. It was all instrumental music for a radio station called 3AK that became a beautiful music station for a little while.
Yeah.
And then the next one, I think, in this order was a band called Bluestone.
Terry Bluestone, Dean, yeah.
John Creech.
Yeah.
And that was on the bootleg label.
Yep.
And I then, all through this, I was doing ads and, you know, that thing where you do ads and you can record it and you hear it straight away on radio or TV and you go, oh, I won't do that again. So you...
Instant feedback, isn't it?
Yes, and immediate. But then when I heard about the band coming in, they were looking for Roger Savage to produce it.
Yes,
And someone else to engineer it. Now... what short story, he dropped out. I was the engineer he was going to choose, and I became the engineer.
Yeah.
Now, Roger had recorded, like, famous records for years, and I think just around then he'd done the Daddy Cool record.
Yeah, and he also did Golden Miles, too. Did he do that? I think he recorded that, Mal Logan was telling me.
But great engineer, and he was the sort of mentor and chief engineer at the studio. And then I said, I'm there doing it, and going, okay, well, there's no producer. The band was the producer.
Yeah.
And didn't really need one because the arrangements were all, you had well, to have it all together.
I mean, I think Graham was definitely steering the helm.
Mm.
There's no doubt about that. I mean, man, I was just a young, snotty-nosed kid. I mean, I was absolutely beside myself. I was kicking myself. I can't believe it. I've been in Australia for just over a year, maybe, came out from Invercargill, New Zealand. I did a tour of Australia with Godspell, about the second or third version of it. And, God, this is going to take... But how I ended up in LRB was I remember meeting a band called Skylight, and Jeff Skews was the keyboard player.
I remember him, yep.
Vibrance, of course, and Trevor Courtney was the drummer. Mike Clark was the bass player.
Wow.
So anyway, we got to know those guys in Perth. And I remember coming back to Melbourne, I had like a cover band, if you like, playing at a nightclub down in the Lower Esplanade called Oscars. And I went to see, remember Oscars down there?
I kind of do.
Yeah.
Yes.
It had the neon sign with the guys playing congas.
I think, yes.
Anyway, I go to see Jeff Skews going, man, can you get me some work? Can you get our band some work? And he said, oh, look, Roger, we don't represent cover bands. We only deal with original acts.
Excuse me.
By the way, there's a band looking for a bass player. He said, do you remember a band called Mississippi? And I went, oh, yeah, I remember Mississippi, Kings of the World, and particularly Willow. Mm. It was a big hit in New Zealand. He said, well, they've broken up. They've come back to Melbourne, and they're looking. They've got themselves a guitar player, and they're looking for a bass player. I said, well, I'd love to audition. I forgot about the cover band I had.
And when was that?
Like, that was 75, like early 75, I think. Yeah. Mm. And he said, okay, well, look, here's the address. He made a phone number to something, gave me the address. And I remember it was either that day or later in the day or the next day. I remember driving to Derek's Polici place in Davis Street, Camberwell, off Burke Road, and I arrive in the blue combi, and I wheel in my Fender rig, which was a Fender Bassman 100 and a 412, and this is the bass I had at the time. It was bought in New Zealand for $400. It had frets in it then. So this is the bass I had, and of course it's the bass you actually hear on the original recording. And so I wheel my gear into the front room there, and they're all set up and
in Derek's house.
Yeah, but in the front kind of front sun lounge. Mm. And there's Derek with his beautiful drum kit and his Fender amplifiers and guitars. And here's the thing. I remember because I was setting up and Graham said, well, asked me a few things. He said, look, we've got this song called, and this is the only thing I can remember from the audition, is he said, we've got this song called It's a Long Way There. He said, look, we'll just start playing it and see what you come up with.
Oh, cool.
Oh, I went, okay. Like, man, I'm on the spot. And I don't know whether they started with the vocal, but I remember hearing them sing, and I went, oh, my God, I'm in the presence of incredible musicians here, and you know, Beeb, and I remember Beeb starting the guitar riff, and they start playing, and Derek plays his fill, and I thought, well, I better play something, and in my mind, the song's in G minor. There's your blues scale, which is kind of what it's based around. And I remember, and I was a great fan of the Eagles and, oh, what's the other LA band? The
Doobie Brothers?
The Eagles and the Doobie Brothers. Loved, I was familiar with a lot of their songs, and I realized, man, I'm in a room with these incredible musicians playing and singing the sort of music I love. Mm. And when Beeb started that riff, it reminded me of a slower version of Long Train Running, which is dang-a-dang-a-dang-a-dang-a-dang-a-dang. So there's similarities, same key, but one's faster, one's slower, but there was some similarity, and I thought, well, I better play something. So I thought, oh, okay, it's a Long Train Running. Very similar. So I kind of started playing a slower version of Long Train Running.
That's great.
So I didn't pinch it, but it's similar. But the reality is that these notes, those notes have been around.
Well, they seem to appear on the bass quite
well. They appear everywhere. It's like playing in a box, and it's all blues based. It's what all bass players kind of noodle on that stuff. Mm. So really what I played in that audition is what you actually kind of hear on the record. It was kind of, obviously things were changed and modified, but the basic idea came from that audition.
Well, we know you got the job.
Well, I got the job. I had to talk Graham into it though.
Oh, really?
Well, I remember playing and I'm thinking to myself, this is like,
you want it.
I want this gig. This band, I'm hearing these guys sing and play. I realised I was in the presence of greatness, and dedicated, incredible musicians. And Graham, in his shyness, was speaking to me outside. Derek's out the front porch, and I'm kind of, okay, well, he said, I remember him saying, Roger, we've got another guy to audition. We're going to get him down from Sydney. We've got one more guy to audition before we make a decision. And my heart sank. I went, oh, no. And I remember boldly saying to Graham, almost verbatim, but I remember saying, Graham, nah, you don't want to do that. I want the job. I actually kind of put my hand up for it. I really want to join this band. I kind of said, nah, you don't want to waste your time flying someone down from Sydney.
I'm here now.
Well, it was a bit like that, I'm here, let's go kind of thing. I was brave enough and bold enough to kind of, and naive enough to say
that. Well, I'm glad
that
you did.
I'm glad I did too.
Mm. That was good. What month? Does this have the month that we recorded it?
Well, I know it was recorded 75 around kind of March April, May.
So the audition would have been January, February.
Well, I don't think it was 74.
Was 74, but
no, it was 75. I know because my mother was not well, and I remember I'd finished my bass parts, and I'd actually flown back to New Zealand to see my mother in hospital. And by the time I got back, I think the album was mixed.
Yes, and the cover was drawn.
Yeah, but Curiosity Killed the Cat didn't come out till November.
We did that as a single recording. I remember that because it came in. Because I think this was only recorded in like a week or 10 days.
Well, you're right. We were flat out working, gigging, and we would find two or three days to go in and play and record. So it was recorded bits and pieces sporadically.
I didn't know that story. I thought, in my head, you'd been touring, doing all those big pubs for a couple of months at least, because I thought I went to see the band and went, wow.
Oh, before we recorded?
Yes.
Oh, look, we definitely were out working under the kind of the name of Mississippi. And, of course, the story of us driving down to Geelong, Glenn Shorrock seeing the sign, the turn off to Little River, thinking, Little River Band. Ooh, LRB, that sounds good. ELO, LRB, all these things, TMG, it abbreviated well. And I remember Glenn saying, it's quite ironic, we go from the biggest river in America to a little river.
Oh, yeah.
That was the irony of it, So, look, we're going to be raving here for hours, and I haven't even played the song yet. So let's dive into the recording. As you were saying, this was all done on a 16-track, 2-inch tape.
Yes.
All in. So I believe that, well, I know for a fact that we had tried to record the song with no click tracks, And because it's so long and there's all these sections and what I call movements and dynamics, we would get halfway through a take and someone would make a mistake and we'd have to stop and start again. And we had several goes at trying to get a take. And it was suggested that maybe we could splice stuff together. And I think, no, come on, we can do this. And I do remember Graham setting up a microphone and orally conducting us through the song. And that's how we got the take, because he had a microphone and he would whisper. He said, okay, we're in the guitar solo now. So start low and then building, 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 which meant I would play my ascending bass line at the end of Rick's extended guitar. So all the things he was directing, and it was the only way we got through the take.
I think that it's one of the things that I gained so much when you played it all live in front of me. The sounds were all there within reason, and at the kind of vibe of the track, the dynamics that you talk about are there. I mean, the strings are overdubbed, the vocals are overdubbed. I think there might have been an acoustic guitar overdubbed.
Yeah.
The only thing dropped in, which was Rick's rhythm after his solo, he suggested that. I think he made a couple of little changes, but everything on the basic band track is
like
you
the
guys
drums,
live.
The bass, Beeb's guitar, Graham's guitar. The little solo thing after Rick's solo.
Yeah.
Ding, 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 ding. That's kind of double tracked with acoustic guitars. And I think there are some acoustic guitars
overdub,
on there that Beeb as an overdub.
Yeah.
But
everybody's playing.
I know, that's it.
Is
all
live.
All of Rick's guitar solo at 21
is
absolutely live. And he had a filthy cold. I remember him feeling really crook. And he was rugged up in the studio with a jumper and a scarf on, with his headphones on, playing guitar like a demon. And when we agreed that was the take, he just downed his guitar and went home.
Mm.
And that's the incredible thing. Oh, here's a pussycat. he was not feeling well when he recorded.
If you listen to every note, like, he's at the height of his powers and just incredible.
No one was playing guitar like that.
No.
You know?
That was also a thing, was like, man,
wow,
this is happening in front of me.
Yeah, it was kind of his approach, his licks. They're kind of inspired by sax players a little bit, some of his stuff.
But the whole band, I mean, that's why I thought that you'd been playing live a lot before.
Well, we had a bit.
Because it was so well thought out. I mean, everything was there, but I know
it was rehearsed.
Was like that.
Yeah, and I remember we did book a farm up in Hillsville for 4 or 5 days, where we did rehearse and rehearse. And Derek decided to go on a brown rice diet in the middle of all that. Yeah, you know, which is probably not a good idea for energy levels. He ended up with a headache.
Oh,
and,
Lord.
Yeah, so. This, of course, this is the album now. Of course, you open up the inside, and there's an actual, not that you can see that, but that's a photograph of us out at Hillsville. The amazing thing is that this photograph I actually took with a telephoto lens, and I took this photograph of Derek and this photograph of Rick in Studio 2. So even though I took these three photographs, I didn't get a credit, but that's okay.
Now, he's got the credit now.
I've got the credit now, just let you know.
Back copyright. Wow, that'd be
And of course, there I am playing the bass slung low, I might add, with still the chrome cap on the back and the pickguard.
See, I thought you were older, but I thought everyone was older than me.
Well, no, Derek, Rick, Derek and myself, we're all the same age pretty much. Yeah, there's not even 6 months between us. Shorrock is actually 10 years older than me.
Wow.
And Beeb and Graham are kind of in between that. They're about 4 or 5 years older than me.
They never reveal their age, do they? Yeah,
but I will, because you work it out. I was 21 in 1975.
Mm. That could be too difficult for some of you.
Oh, do the maths. So, look, it was all in live, and Peter Jones did the string arrangement. Peter Jones also did the string arrangement on Kings of the World.
That's probably where
I always thought Rick had done it, but Rick did the strings on the second album. I digress.
I think he might have been pushing to do it.
He was.
He was certainly, he kept outgrowing his musical circumstances at each stage, which was always great to watch, but I wanted him to stay in the band for a lot longer because of just how good he was in the band.
Well, he didn't want to stay. He really didn't like the regiment of the band.
He
had to play the same thing every night. And there's a wonderful quote from Rick where he said, I'd got sick of LRB. I felt like I was in the Glenn Shorrock cabaret band.
which is only half the truth.
Yeah, and of course, you know, with Glenn kind of dancing around the stage across the stage like Mick Jagger, you know, standing and stumbling all over Rick's pedals on the floor, you know. And he goes, get out of here. You switch my phaser on.
They're great insights. I don't...
Yeah, well, I do remember those things happening. So Rick wanted to leave, and I got the boot, but that's another story.
Which I thought was outrageous. But
I'll
do a separate video about that.
Yes, I did. And I've subsequently had a great rave to Graham about that just recently, only in the last few weeks. And he actually said to me, he said, Roger, he said, that must have been devastating for you. And I said, well, yeah, it was. But I said, I get it now. I didn't get it then. But when I heard what George was doing, I realised what the band was looking for. They were looking for that next level. But it gave me a real kick up the backside to be a better bass player after that. There's no doubt about it. When I heard what George was doing, I mean, it hurt, you know. I'm hearing him slap. I wasn't slapping and playing fingers. I'm hacking away on a pick, you know, being a pop star, you know. Enjoying the fruits of being a young boy on Countdown, you know, it was a thrill for me. It was like, man, this is what I dreamed about when I was 10 years old. You know, I wanted to be a pop star. So all of a sudden, here I was thrust into the limelight, and maybe I should have taken it more serious at the time. But as Graham said, because Graham believes that things are all preordained a little bit, and this is part of your journey. He said, you were meant to be an LRB, but you're also meant not to be an LRB, to go on and be the musician that you've become. That was nice of him to put it like that. But look, I have no regrets, and if I had the chance, I wouldn't change a thing. You know, I would not change a thing, because I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you or have the wonderful people and the love that I have in my life now.
Well said.
Yeah, there you go. So, look, we could rave about... How long have we been raving for? 23 minutes, and we haven't even got to the song yet.
That's okay. It's an epic
song. I've got to remember an 8.5-minute song. So I'm now going to attempt to play this verbatim, note for note, with a pick. I had to kind of relearn. I realised that even though I'm a finger player now, it was played in pick, and there's a certain amount of up and down strokes that are part of the charm, you know. So I believe it was recorded with both pickups flat out. I didn't even know you could play with the back pickup.
So again, this isn't the bass?
No, but it's a jazz bass.
That bass you showed earlier is the bass, just sitting here watching, which is
good. It's just here, because it doesn't want to be left out.
No.
It's still here, you know, but it's fretless, and it just doesn't sound right playing it on the fretless.
No, that's fair enough. But these are the same hands that you used.
Yes, they are the same hands. You're dead right. So here I go. I don't think there's anything else that we've actually missed.
Just keep on going.
I think we should just keep going, because we've been raving for way too long.
No, I think the right amount of time.
Yeah. So here I go. I'm going to attempt to play the long version of It's a Long Way There. So wish me luck.
Good luck.
I'm getting nervous now, Ross.
No, you're just...
Look, I'm just going to turn that mic away a little bit. No, what I'll do is I'll just turn the gain down a bit, because the mic picks up too much of that.
Okay.
So I'll just turn that down to... -10. Remember to turn that
this
up.
This is also live, this video.
This is all
overdubs.
So here we go. He sang these lines to me.
Great. sitting so close to you doing it. You were in the, there was a window between us last time.
Yeah, you were right on top of me then.
Yeah, that's good.
Oh, my little heart's going.
You did. It was good.
Yeah, I missed a couple of little things. Little bits.
We should talk. The chorusing is because Roger's in tune, and that's from 1974. No, that's not the case, but it was analog tape, and somewhere along the line, the pitch has gone.
From various tapes and back and forth, speeds of motors, all those things.
That was recorded on an Optro, Australian-built 16-track multi-track. Which really good machines, except that they were never really finished off properly. They didn't. The component parts weren't ideal, and things went wrong. We did go to 24-track Optros after that, which are also great sounding machines. But pitch on analog tape, it can vary from the start of the reel to the end of the reel. Now, I don't know whether the pitch sounded as if it's held there. So
it's pretty good.
They held pretty well, the machines, but on the 1600 Ampexes, which were the next machines, they'd vary a lot from pitch from the start of the reel to the end, and to the point where you'd have to get a vary speed or a solid electronic source to try and stabilize it, or that's what we tried to do. But that's why the bass is chorusing.
Yeah, a little bit. Mm. And when I did Curiosity Killed the Cat, I actually had to tune the bass to the track.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, I actually had to go. I think I went a little bit above 440.
Now, there's things that could happen that maybe down the line someone decided to speed it up because of some reason.
Yes, well, I've had that. Yeah, I wonder whether the track had been very sped slightly in the mix.
Analog tape, that's why, in one sense, digital's a great format because there is no variance. You have to force the variance into it, whereas analog tape, it would be there.
Well, that's all part of the charm, isn't it, really?
Well, no, not at midnight when you're trying to do a bass overdub and it's not in tune with the track and then you spend an hour tuning something to try and tune to the track. But anyway, that's another story.
You're right. I'm being an old guy and being in recording and the days of, I know how a bass sounds. Mm. When you plug it into a DI, you compress it a little bit so that it doesn't go into the red on the tape. And so you listen to that while you're recording, but when it comes off the playback head, the bottom end and the fatness, it's called tape compression, is that correct?
No, that's to do with bias.
Bias and saturation?
Some tapes have, so the Ampex machines, they had good bottom end. Well, they had an enhanced bottom end. And sometimes you'd have to anticipate that. And that's to do with how the machines lined up sometimes, and some people go for that, and in a sense the thing that's missing from digital are those things like the way that a bass sounds on it. Even drums have tape compression.
Well, that was my point, because I see a lot of guys on bass forums and they're going, look, how do I get a big fat sound out of my jazz bass or my P bass? And I go, well, first of all, there's so many variables. I mean, are you talking about a particular recording that you like? And if so, tell me which one. Yes. Is it something that was recorded in the 70s? Because if it was on tape, then there's a whole bunch of variables.
You go back further with all the valve, Beatles sounds, which you go back to that and you go, ooh. But there's aspects about those sounds because of the equipment. And if Jeff Emmerich talks about it in his book, when they went to solid state stuff, he couldn't get the sounds that he used to get because the whole EMI would just naturally change, have to update because that's what their budget said to do. But the valve, I miss the valve era. I got to work with my...
Well, it does add a certain amount of dirtiness to it.
The distortion in valve equipment,
it's pleasant.
Is a beautiful.
Yeah, it's pleasant.
Distortion.
Yeah.
The distortion in digital equipment is horrendous.
Yeah, look, the plugins are getting better. There's no doubt about it. And my bass amp farm on Logic, I can kind of push an Ampeg amp and get that, the plugins that sound like old.
I say plugins, schmuggins.
Schmuggins. Well, look, you're right. Anyway, we've got into a technical rave now.
Yeah, that's.
When I go to upload this to YouTube, you realise it's going to be rejected. I'm sorry, the file's too big and we won't...
Oh, really?
No.
That's
but
good.
But it'll be a bit. Ross, we could talk about this stuff for hours.
That's just one track.
Just one track,
And then after hours, that's another story again.
Well, that is, yes. So, look, I really thank you for coming down today. It's I know people, apart from me hacking away on my bass, I understand now that people actually love the backstory and an insight as to how we went about and to record these songs.
It's been great
I'm very proud of this stuff. I mean, it's a fabulous legacy to.
Well, it did all right, didn't it?
Yeah, it did all right, mate. Yeah,
the songs, the singers, the players. I mean,
yeah, it's just that we all hate one another now, and we're never going to play again. I'm joking.
And that's the thing. It did very well, and I can remember when we went in to do After Hours, there was a certain kind of. It was a little more relaxed.
Oh, absolutely, it was. Yeah.
And it was. As joyful. Well, it was.
And it was a bit like the early Allman Brothers. We were never about trying to make a 4-minute, 3-minute pop tune single. It was about, After Hours to me was a band album, you know, and it was about, let's just go on and make a great album of great music. And that's what I love about.
Yes.
I love about After Hours. Yeah, there's a couple of cool pop tunes, but the stuff that I like the most are just kind of just cool tracks, you know.
But this is where it began. And well, I didn't realise how close to the start of it I just had this in my head that at least a year you'd been together or something.
No, well, it was 74 I came out, and it really it would have been early 75 I joined the band.
And then into the studio.
I actually have a breakdown of all the gigs that I did with the band. Every date, venue, and I don't know when we had time to sleep. I mean, we were just zigzagging, flying. Later on, we were flying. But where we found, I'm trying to figure out the window of opportunity to record that album, because we would work Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, sometimes two gigs on a Saturday, in the studio Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, back out Thursday, Friday, Saturday gig, back in the studio Monday, Tuesday. It was just constant.
And but the way of life, you wouldn't have changed that either, would you? You would have been
For me, it was just fun. I was living the dream, man. Mm. Yeah, you know, it was.
And when there's a photograph of you setting fire to something in the fish and chip shop, the Blue Dolphin around the corner from the studio, was that on the back of After Hours, or was that?
I hope not.
I thought maybe there's a photograph.
Setting fire to something.
Oh, it was just you set fire to something in the ashtray.
Oh,
And it was, there were publicity shots, but I think that photo shoot, there is a photograph of that time on one of those albums, but I remember seeing the one where there was flames.
Oh, and you flames were doing coming this. Out, yeah. Actually, the back of the After Hours was in a burger joint up in Mooney Ponds, up that way. That's where that was shot, yeah.
Mm.
In a milk bar somewhere, and chip shop.
Yeah.
But I do remember, what was it called, the Blue Dolphin?
Blue Dolphin.
The taxi. It was the only place it was open at 10, 11.
No, that's the taxi. That's Silvertops.
Silvertop Taxi, now. Yeah, around the corner.
Mixed Grill at midnight.
Mixed Grill, that was us. Mixed Grill at midnight,
We'd all go there for that time. And that's gone now, unfortunately.
Yeah, great mixed days. Mixed
Grill, I'd probably order it once a year now.
Mm. I'd mixed grill, hold the meat, no bacon. All right, look, I don't know how long this video is now. 40 minutes? 32? 42 minutes, excellent.
Well, it's a long song.
Well, it's a long song, and it's a long way there. Oh, well, thank you, Graham. It's a wonderful song that you wrote, and it kind of really sums it all up. So thanks for picking me. All right, better sign off and go and let this upload and top and tail it. And I'm going to sprinkle in some black and white photographs from that actual recording that I stumbled across the other day.
And we're both going to be tested after this, so don't worry about that.
Yes, so if you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask me on the YouTube link, which is just, well, you know what it is because you're already there, aren't you? Silly me.
What a world.
All right, wind it up. Okay, that is a wrap. Cut. And thank you, Ross.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, excellent. Bye. Phew.
Well done.